श्री अभिषेक एक बार उसको।
यस सर, आवाज आ रही है मेरी?
ओके, मैं ब्रॉडकास्ट पे क्लिक कर रहा हूँ। इन 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 हो गया।
Okay, good afternoon, one and all. On behalf of the IEEE Computer Society and Techno India Engineering Institute of Technology, Udaipur, welcome today's speaker, Dr. Pankaj Kumar Porwal, Principal of Techno India NJR. He is the BTech from the IIT Bombay and PhD from Cornell. Today's webinar topic is Deep Learning for Image-Based Tasks. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Abhishek, for the introduction. And as Abhishek mentioned, the topic for today's seminar or webinar is deep learning for image-based tasks. Can everybody hear me? And can everybody see the screen?
Yes.
Okay. So the one of the motivation for deep learning for image-based tasks is a desire to impart the computers which are found in self-driving cars to understand the environment around the car using feedback of the camera so that the car's computer can understand the environment the way humans do and can take decisions which are mainly driving decisions or safe driving decisions. And that way we can achieve the ability of having self-driving cars. And before I get into this, let us understand overall, this deep learning is part of a bigger field called artificial intelligence. And the artificial intelligence is basically a desire to impart machines kind of intelligence humans have. And to understand that, let's first understand what is intelligence. And if I ask Google, what is intelligence? Then Google definition says intelligence is ability to acquire and apply knowledge and skills, and humans naturally possess this ability and machines do not, or rather I should say machines did not possess that ability. Today there are many algorithms that perform even better than human intelligence at specific tasks. We still don't have what is called AGI, artificial general intelligence, but for specific tasks there are algorithms that do at par or even better than what humans can do. So why this has not been achieved so far, and the problem lies with the traditional computer programming approach or traditional computer algorithm approach, where we are given an input and we have to come up with an algorithm that will give us desired output. And this output, even though it plays very important role in deciding output for a given input, but for other inputs this output has no role to play. And that is one of the major limitations why our traditional computer algorithms do not exhibit intelligent behavior. And to understand that in more detail, let's consider an example of one algorithm. Let's say we are given a natural number and we want to find whether the given natural number is an even number or not. And the simple algorithm for that can be, we divide that number by 2 and find the remainder. That is easy, can be done easily. And we check if the remainder is 0, then our output should be yes, the given number is even. And if our remainder is 1, then our answer should be no, that the given number is not an even number. Now, can we use same or similar approach for image-based tasks? And what do I mean by image-based tasks? So in such tasks, we are given an input image. And the question that generally asked is, a particular object or a particular animal or a particular thing is present in the image or not. So for example, if I am given an image and It could be an image of a dog, or there could be no dog in the image. And the question that generally can be asked is there a dog in the given image? And if there is a dog, then our answer should be yes. And if our image does not have dog, say the image has cat or any other animal or any other thing for that matter, then our output should be no. So how do we, or the other kind of task or simple task that we can think of is we are given an image and the question that we are asked is what is there in the image, or identify the name of thing or animal or object that is present in the image. So for example, here, if there is a dog in the image, then our output should be dog. And if there is a cat in the image, our output should be cat. So let's go back to the first example that we discussed, and that is of identifying whether there is a dog in our image or not. So we will be given an image and our question will be, is there a dog in the given image? And if there is a dog, then our answer should be yes. And if I try to devise an algorithm for identifying that, some of the questions that I can ask are based on characteristics of a dog. For example, some of the questions that I can ask, or I can check whether the thing in image has four legs, whether it has two ears, it has two eyes, has a tail, or there can be a long list of questions that we can check. Now, the question is whether this approach is going to give us correct answer, or whether it is going to give us correct answer with reasonably high accuracy. And as it turns out, this approach fails miserably at even identifying a dog based on these quantifiable characteristics, let alone the non-quantifiable or qualitative characteristics that make a dog a dog. For example, if I look at this image, I can only see two legs. So should I classify this animal as dog or not? Here, I don't see any leg at all. Here, I don't see two legs, the hind legs. I can only see the front two legs. Here, I don't see the eyes or the mouth. Here, again, I don't see the eyes or the top part of the dog. So even our traditional algorithm will fail miserably in identifying the object correctly, even for quantifiable characteristics of that entity or object in our image. And if we talk about the qualitative characteristics that make a dog, then there is no chance that they'll give any reasonable result, because there are hundreds of species of dog, and the appearance of a dog can vary anywhere from a donkey to a wolf, and anywhere from a cat to a lion. And it's not just the other living animals that compete with dogs. Even there are many inanimate, that is non-living things, that compete with dogs in looking like dogs. And it ranges from mop, for example, here we have images of Hungarian sheepdog and images of a mop. And it is almost impossible, or it will almost be impossible for traditional algorithm to distinguish between these two. There are muffins that look almost like dogs. There are bagels that look almost like dog, or the dog may look almost like bagels. So distinguishing our image for these kind of complicated or complex similarities and differences will be almost impossible for traditional computer algorithms. Even if we look at the major challenges, the same thing when looked from different angles may appear completely different in different lighting conditions. The same things will look totally different. The things can have very small size or very large size, and still we should be able to identify the image. There can be a lot of deformation or distortion in our image. there may be a lot of background clutter, which is very similar to our image. And there are parts of the image that may be hidden, or there may be a lot of variation within a particular class of objects or image. So the next question that comes to us is then, how do we train, or how do we write, or how do we develop an algorithm that can perform image related tasks the way humans do? And for that, we actually draw inspiration from the way humans see things and the way humans understand things. So here is a very simple sketch of the process by which humans see things and understand things. Any image or any object is observed or seen by eyes. The eye converts that signal or whatever it sees into an electrical signal, and that signal is passed to the brain. And in the brain of humans, there is a complex network of neurons that almost looks like a large number of entangled and knotty fibers. And in an adult human brain, there are close to 100 billion neurons. And each of these neurons are connected to thousands of other neurons. And if we look at a single neuron, there are three, we can say there are three main parts. One, the main body, then there are tentacles or fibers or dendrites pointing out from this round part as well as from this elongated part. And if we see a more accurate model of that neuron, then this part is the main body of the neuron. I'll not go too much into biology of the neuron, but let's understand what are the main parts. So this is the main body of the neuron. These tentacles, I'll call them links for simplicity. These links are actually input links, and this main body is the processing unit of the neuron, which processes the inputs received by these links, and then the output of that processed input is passed along this long fiber, which is called axon, and then it is passed on to other neurons. So this basically is summary of how our neuron receives input and passes the output to other neurons. Now, next question that comes is, this structure of brain is fine. There are neurons, but exactly how do our brain, or how do these neurons interpret or learn to recognize objects? And that process is also very interesting. When we start, for example, a human child who is very young, and the child has never seen a dog, and when the child sees a dog for the first time, the child has no conception of what a dog is. And there is no way for her to know that the animal or the creature that she's seeing is a dog. So she may just never know what a dog is, or some adult, say a parent or uncle, might tell her that that thing that you are seeing is a dog. And when next time the child sees some animal which looks similar to dog, she may recognize that animal as dog or not dog. And when she recognizes that animal as dog, the elder person will correct her that no, this is not a dog. This is probably a cat or a cow or some other animal. And if she identifies that animal correctly, then the parents will be very happy that the child has learned to identify a dog. And this process of correcting the child if she's making a mistake, and encouraging her or giving her a positive response when she identifies that object correctly, makes these neurons, some of these links of the neuron stronger and other links weaker. in a way, these links either become stronger and they amplify the signal coming in, or they become weak and they reduce the signal coming in. And this model of neuron can be represented mathematically like this. We have the main body of the neuron, which is called node. We have these links. On the left side of our node, we have input links. And on the right side of that neuron, we have output links. And each of the link has some strength, and that strength is denoted by weight of the link. So any input passing through a particular link, the magnitude of that input will be multiplied by the weight. And all the inputs will either be amplified or reduced depending on the magnitudes of these weights. Once these signals, either amplified or reduced, reach our node, there are two things that happen in our node. First part, which is performed by summation function, which combines all these inputs and adds a constant term, which is called bias of the node, and feeds that to our activation function. And the output of this activation function forms output of our neuron. And that output is passed on to other neurons through the output links of this neuron. So this is basic structure of neuron, or rather this is the mathematical representation of structure of a neuron. And there are many different types of activation functions that we can use, but I'll not go into details of that. And we can combine such neurons to form a network of neurons, which is called artificial neural network. We call it artificial because it is not a real neural network, which is found in human brain. And the way in which I have arranged these nodes and the way I have connected these nodes is called architecture of our artificial neural network. And we'll come to that more. So in a way, we have modeled, or we have developed a model of neural network of human brain. And the way humans see a dog and interpret it, we expect our neural network to see a dog and interpret that as a dog. So next part comes, how do we teach this artificial neural network to identify a dog as a dog? And that's where the next term, that is machine learning, comes. We want this artificial neural network to learn from some, or learn using some technique or some method. And when we talk about machine learning, the machine is nothing but a computer program or a software or an algorithm. And learning basically means estimating the values of parameters in our model. And in the case of artificial neural network, those parameters are the weights of the links and biases of the nodes. These numbers, wij, w1j, w2j, and so on. So if somehow we can find these weights, so that any input signal to our artificial neural network can be either enhanced or amplified or reduced, and then passed along this network till this last node, which is called output node, and the output of this last node can be interpreted as a dog or no dog. And how do we do that? Here also, we use almost same approach that humans learn, or the same approach which humans use to learn. And that is supervised, that is called supervised learning in machine learning terminology, where we are given some input, we pass that input to our machine learning model, which in this case is an artificial neural network, and it gives some output. And what we expect for this image of a dog is that output should be dog. Now, when we initiate or when we initialize this network, the weights and the biases of the nodes are initialized randomly. So the actual output of our machine learning model will not be the expected output. It will be different from that. That is, there will be some error, and the expected output will supervise or in a way control the actual output and define what we call error function or loss function, which is difference between the actual output and expected output of our input. And our objective is to minimize this difference or the error function or loss function. And that's why the error function or loss function is also called objective function. And this type of training data, where we know both the input and expected output, is called labeled training data, because for every input, we know the expected label of that input. And this type of learning is called supervised learning, because it is happening under supervision of expected output, sort of. So now, how do we minimize this error? And there is one simple algorithm for that. And that algorithm works on, that algorithm is based on numerical method. And because in numerical methods, our weights and biases will converge to actual or final weights and biases in a sort of step-by-step manner. And because our weights and biases converge towards final answer, slowly, this process of estimating these weights and biases is called learning or training of neural network. And the most common algorithm that is used for minimizing our error function or for estimating our parameters is called gradient descent, where for some randomly initialized values of weights and biases, say my error value is somewhere here for this error surface, and my objective is to minimize the error value. That means I want to reach the bottommost point of this surface, and this is my starting point. And from this starting point to this last point, there are several ways in which I can go. I can go along a winding path, like most of the roads in hilly or in a valley part of mountains are, or I can go on a zigzag path, but these are not very efficient. The most common and most efficient method to do that is to move along the direction of maximum slope. And that's why this algorithm is known as gradient descent algorithm. Gradient is nothing but another term for slope, and descent means we are getting down along the maximum slope so that we reach the point of minimum in most efficient manner. And when we are moving towards our point of minimum, the step size that we take is called learning rate. And depending on what is the learning rate or our step size, we may reach our point of minimum very quickly or slowly. And the best way to select our learning rate, that it should neither be too large or too small, because if the learning rate is too large, then we reach the point of minimum quickly, but we may miss the true minimum. And if our step size is small, there will be more likelihood of reaching the point of minimum, but it will take longer. So the most common approach that is used in practice is that of adaptive learning rate, where we start with larger steps, and then as we proceed or move towards our point of minimum, we reduce our step size or learning rate. So now the structure of our algorithm is clear. The process of training our algorithm is clear. The next challenge or the next problem that we face is exactly how do we feed image of a dog to our neural network, which is nothing our model, which is nothing but a neural network, and it expects some numbers as input. And in the case of images, that is relatively easy when we compare that to other problems for which deep learning is used, that is natural language processing. There, the quantifying an input itself is a big challenge, but in the case of image, it is relatively easy because the composition of an image has physical meaning, and the physical meaning is that a color image can be decomposed into three primary colors, that is red, green, and blue. And any color given on an image can be made by combination of these three colors with different intensity. And in modern computers, most of the modern computers, all three of the channels have intensity varying from 0 to 255. So depending on what is the intensity of each of the color, we will get different colors on our image. And another way to decompose a color image is into pixels, which is nothing but a picture element. So the entire visible part of that image can be specified as composed of small pixels, and each pixel has three color channels. So effectively, a color image can be represented by a three-dimensional array of numbers, where each number represents intensity of a particular color for a particular pixel. So for example, for top left pixel, the intensity of red color is 23, here intensity of green color is 37, and intensity of blue color is 41. And when we combine all three of them, we get some particular image corresponding to that pixel. And if we have a grayscale image, then we don't need these three channels, because the values of red, green, and blue channels are exactly same. So that information can be stored in just a single two-dimensional array like this. So for a grayscale image, we only need a two-dimensional array or matrix. And these higher dimensional arrays are also called tensors. So now we have the process of, or now we have the structure of our algorithm, we have process of training our algorithm, and we also have a way to quantify our input. So next problem that we face with this particular structure of our neural network is the way we have arranged our nodes. All the nodes in a particular layer are in a column, that is just a single one-dimensional array, whereas our image of a dog is in three-dimensional array. So how do we convert this three-dimensional array into a one-dimensional input? There are many ways. One of the ways is to cut the vertical slices of these matrices and stack them on one top of another, something like this. So this red channel has three columns. I cut the vertical slices and I stack these vertical slices on top of each other. Then I do same for green channel. Then I do same for blue channel. So from my three-dimensional array, I can get a one-dimensional array of numbers, which I can feed to my artificial neural network, and I can get a desired output if my network is well-trained. And I train my network in supervised manner using gradient descent algorithm. And there are many simple tasks at which such structure of artificial neural network does very well. One example is recognizing handwritten digits. And many artificial neural networks have been trained that give accuracy of almost 99%+ accuracy. And this does reasonably well. But when it comes to real life images, the kind of images that we click with our mobile camera every day, the kind of images or the videos a camera on self-driving car will receive are far more complex than simple handwritten images. And this structure of artificial neural network is not able to handle that kind of task with high accuracy. So the next challenge that comes, why the given structure, which is also called architecture of our neural network, is not able to perform the tasks involving more complex or real images that we deal with on day by day basis. And the problem lies in, again, the architecture of our neural network. And I did not describe this architecture in detail earlier, but let's understand this in slightly more detail. First, all the neurons, and mind it, this is not exactly same as the neural network in human brain, because that is very complex nature, that is very complex network. Here we arrange all the nodes in layers, and in each layer the nodes are arranged in columns. And this kind of architecture requires breaking down our three-dimensional array into a one-dimensional array. And if we look at, or if we consider that from the point of view of an image, what we are doing is we are cutting vertical slices of our image and stacking those slices on top of each other, or we can think of that as cutting horizontal slices of our image, then rotating those slices and stacking those slices on top of each other. And this kind of slicing and stacking leads to loss of spatial information. And by this loss of spatial information, what I mean is that the pixels have particular interpretation based on the way they are arranged in space. And if I distort that spatial arrangement of pixels, then a lot of useful information will be lost. For example, here I have disturbed only small number of pixels, and that has resulted in significant distortion in the image. And in fact, if I move some more pixels, then it will almost be impossible even for humans to recognize that image. So this one-dimensional layers of neurons is one of the problems why artificial neural networks do not have or cannot achieve high accuracy for more complex images. Second problem, again, with artificial neural network comes from their architecture, and that is the way neurons in layers are connected. So for a regular artificial neural network, these are called fully connected networks. And by fully connected, I mean each node in a layer is connected to every node in the previous layer and every node in the next layer. And this leads to very large number of weights in our network. Or effectively, this leads to very large number of parameters in our machine learning model. And that becomes a problem when we move from small images to large images, which are common nowadays. So the example of handwritten digits that I gave, these images were actually very small images, around, I think, 8x8 or 28 pixel by 28 pixel, which is nothing. So if I consider this image to be of small size, say 8 pixel by 8 pixel, and if it is a color image, then there will be 8 pixel by 8 pixel into 3 matrices. And if I stack them in a vertical one-dimensional array, then there will be a vector of size 192. And that will lead to this kind of artificial neural network, where the first layer, which is input layer, is 192 nodes. And because each of the neuron in, or each of the node in next layer is connected to every node in this layer, so there will be total 192 links for each neuron in the next layer, and that will result in 192 weights and one bias for just one neuron. Now, when I do same calculation for a regular real life image, and few megapixel image is very common nowadays. So if I do the same calculation for 1 megapixel image, which has 1000 pixel by 1000 pixel size, then the size of the one dimensional input vector will be 3 × 10⁶. And what that means is that there should be, or we need to have, more than 1 million nodes in input layer, and that will lead to 3 × 10⁶, that is more than 1 million weights for every node in the next layer. So this idea is called the poor scalability of artificial neural networks with size of input. Means when our input is small, there will be very small number of parameters in our model, but as our input size grows, the number of parameters will grow disproportionately. And another thing is that if all these inputs were relevant for our task of prediction, if all these inputs were useful in identifying a dog in our image or a person in our image, then we will have no choice but to consider all these inputs. But the reality is completely different from this. The reality is that almost 70% to 80% of these inputs have no role to play in our prediction task. For example, if I take the example of detecting face of a person in an image, then the face will constitute only say about 10 or 15% or 20% at the most of that image. So here we know that only 10 to 20% of these 1 million nodes are useful. But the problem with images is that we never know in advance exactly where the object that we desire will lie. It can lie anywhere from top left corner to bottom right corner. So in a way, we do not have any way of knowing which of these nodes are useful for a given input. So we can say these nodes sort of have a split personality. That is, for some of the inputs, the nodes will be carrying, or for some of the images, these nodes will be carrying very relevant inputs. And for other images, these will be carrying irrelevant inputs that have no role to play in our prediction. So how do we overcome these problems? And these problems are overcome by changing the architecture of our neural network. And by architecture, I mean the way nodes are arranged in layers and the way nodes in different layers are connected. And again, the inspiration is drawn from the structure of things that we deal with. And if you remember, the images of, or the color images of things have numbers arranged in three-dimensional array. And now if we can change the architecture of our neural network so that rather than arranging our nodes in one-dimensional array or columns, if we arrange them in three-dimensional array, then we can feed an image as it is without distorting that image. So the first problem of slicing our input image and stacking that is overcome by changing our architecture, where we had one dimensional array of nodes, to architecture where we have three dimensional array of nodes. And that architecture is called convolutional neural network. And why it is called convolutional neural network, I'll explain in a moment, but that is called convolutional neural network. And in convolutional neural network, each layer has nodes which are arranged in three dimension. So each layer has a width, a height and a depth. So with this kind of architecture, a color image can be fed to our network as it is without any change in the image. So the first layer of that network consisting of input nodes will have three layers along the depth dimension, and width and height will be same as width and height of our image. So with this kind of architecture, all our information will be passing through this network as a three-dimensional array. And as we saw, a three-dimensional array is called a tensor. So literally, our information tensor flows through the network to give us the desired prediction. And in fact, this is the reason why the Google's deep learning platform is called TensorFlow, because tensors are flowing through our convolutional neural network. So this overcomes first problem with architecture of artificial neural network, that is of having to split our image into vertical or horizontal slices. The next problem of scalability with size of input is overcome by another change in architecture of convolutional neural network. Unlike artificial neural network, where we have fully connected layers, in convolutional layers or convolutional neural network, we have what is called local connectivity. That means any neuron in output layer is connected only to a small number of neurons in input layer. And the connections are complete along the depth, but they are partial in width and height direction. So each neuron in output is connected to very small number of neurons in input layer. Second idea that is used to reduce number of parameters, and that is of weight sharing. And by weight sharing, what I mean is that all the neurons in one particular slice of output share the weights. So for example, here this neuron is connected to some of the neurons in our input layer, and these links have some weight. When we move to the next neuron, then our neurons in input volume will also shift, and the same weights will be carried to next set of neurons. So these weights will be shared by all the neurons in this particular slice of our output. And this combination of weight is also called filter, because our neurons are arranged in three-dimensional array. Our weights are also arranged in a three-dimensional array, and these weights are superimposed on our input volume, and the inputs of those nodes are multiplied with the corresponding weights. Now, in convolutional neural networks, this three-dimensional array of weight is also called filter or kernel. And this is called filter because this three-dimensional array of weights is actually, as it turns out, is scanning our input volume for specific features, almost like a detective who looks for entire area of crime scene for clues, one part after another. Our filter looks for features in our input volume, and the filter keeps track of presence or absence of feature as output of these nodes in our output volume, or rather this slice of our output volume. So a particular slice of output volume keeps track of a particular feature in our input volume, and that's why a slice of nodes in our output volume is called a feature map. So if we look at this process, I have one video So just give me one moment. I'll show you that video exactly how this process happens. So here we slide our filter, which is nothing but a three-dimensional array of weights, along our width of the input and throughout the depth of the input, and the result of product of the activations of input volume with weights is stored in one layer of our output volume. And this process of sliding our filter through input volume is called convolution, and that's how these convolutional neural networks get their name. And if we compare the number of parameters, that is number of weights in a convolutional layer or in convolutional neural network, when I go from this layer to this next layer, and if I use a 3x3 filter, then there will be 3 × 3, 9 weights in first layer, 9 weights in second layer, and 9 weights in third layer, that is total 27 weights. And that is irrespective of size of my input image. So unlike the artificial neural network, where the number of weights in the layer scale with size of input, in convolutional neural network, irrespective of size of the input, the number of weights for a particular slice of output will remain constant, and that is also very small number that only depends on size of filter. Now we don't have to have just one filter for each input. We can have a collection of filters, and each filter will give us one slice of our output, and that slice of output will correspond to activations for that filter, that is presence or absence of a particular feature in our in different parts of our input. And in last one decade or last 5 to 7 years, very good accuracy has been achieved by these convolutional neural network. And rather than going into the mathematical part of why these networks perform so well, I'll explain that in more conceptual way. And that is, these convolutional neural networks exploit a property of natural signals, and that is the composition property of natural signals. And by composition property, what I mean is that very complex structure can be obtained by hierarchical combination of very simple elements. For example, if we consider an image, one of the simplest building block of an image can be thought of as just a line segment or an edge. And if I combine many of these small edges, I can form the complex parts of a human's face. For example, eye, nose, lips, ear. And if I combine these complex parts, which are made using combination of these simple parts, I can create face of a human. And using same basic building blocks, we can create millions of faces of humans, which are both distinguishable and identifiable. So, and the convolutional neural networks exploit this idea of compositional nature of natural signals. And how do they do? Is by using these filters. And these filters in earlier layer of our network extract the most basic or simplest features in our input. And as we move along the depth or along our network, these simple features are combined into more and more complex features. And when we reach end of our network, that leads to prediction about whatever problem that we are interested in. And several researchers have done studies about exactly what the neurons in different layers are learning or extracting. And they have found that they are actually extracting simple features, and the complexity of these features increase as we move along the depth of our network. So initial few layers just extract simple features like edges. The intermediate layers extract features which are obtained by combination of these simple features. And the last layers extract or learn the features which are combination of the intermediate level features. And it is not just for faces. You take any example, be it cars or animals or piece of furniture, and same hierarchical structure or same hierarchy.
I think there is a technical glitch. We are waiting for our speaker. Just give us a couple of minutes. Let's wait for 2 to 3 minutes so the speaker can join as soon as possible. Extremely sorry for inconvenience. Let's just wait for 2 to 3 minutes.